Our today topic is the root locus. Root locus. Today, the mainly content gonna be how can we sketch the root locus from the system transfer function. How can we sketch the root locus from the system transfer function? Before today class, maybe you should familiar with pole and zero of system, pole and zero of system. And we may know that when we change the gain, the controller gain of the system, we're gonna change the position of the pole of the system. And sometime when we increase the gain to some value, maybe the system may change from the stable to unstable behavior, depending on the position of the pole on the S plane. Maybe originally the system is stable, but when we increase the gain, the position of the pole of the system changed. Maybe if it changed to the right hand side of the S plane, the system gonna be unstable. Today, the root locus method is the way to analyze the system. It's the way to check the position of the pole when we change the value of the gain. So the application of the root locus method gonna be, maybe we just use it for analyze the system to indicate whether the system gonna be stable or unstable, or gonna have the big or small damping ratio. Or the root locus method gonna be the way that we use to decide controller. It's one technique, one useful technique. And today main content gonna be how can we sketch the root locus by hand. And we're gonna introduce the concept of the root locus, how can it relate to the transfer function. And we're gonna introduce the guideline for sketch root locus by hand when we don't have computational tools. And it's gonna be complete, not gonna be complete by today. We still have another two bullets to talk about again on next 2 weeks in our next class. And of course, most of the content in our course, I'm gonna begin from the analytical way, the way that we can do by hand on a paper. And then we're gonna have the MATLAB tool that we can use as alternative and to cross check what we can do. So for the real work, maybe you may focus on the MATLAB tools, but we have the background idea, the background knowledge, how the MATLAB tool work. And when you understand the concept, the tool gonna be more powerful when you use the computational tools. And today, so mainly, how can we plot the root locus from the transfer function is the key for today's class. Next class, we have MATLAB tool, and how can we apply the locus, how can we apply the root locus to check the system property and to decide controller. So from the transfer function here, we may, it should be good for us to begin from what is the pole and zero of from the transfer function. What are the pole and zero from this transfer function? This transfer function relate output divided by the input, and output divided by input, and it's a good reveal. The zero from this transfer function, the zero can be obtained from the polynomial of the numerator equal to zero. The zero gonna make the polynomial equal to zero, and we have one zero for this case, and that zero, the value gonna be minus 1/2. If s equal to minus 1/2, the numerator of this transfer function gonna be zero. For the pole, the polynomial for the denominator the pole is the root of the characteristic equation. This is characteristic equation. The polynomial for the denominator equal to zero is the characteristic equation. And the root of the characteristic equation are the pole of the system. This system may have P1 or the first pole equal to minus 1. And the second pole of this system is minus 2. It means if s equal to minus 1, the characteristic equation gonna be 0. Or another possible value of the s that make the characteristic equation become 0 is the pole equal to minus 2. We have two possible value. And if this is the transfer function of the system, if this is a transfer function of this system, do you remember the impulse response? If the input of this system is impulse, the transfer function of the input is equal to 1. And the impulse response, we need to obtain the inverse Laplace of GS. The impulse response is the inverse Laplace transform of the transfer function GS. The way that we can obtain the inverse Laplace, we should begin from the partial fraction. The partial fraction from this transfer function, it can be separated to and partial fraction so we have a plus b equal to 2, and we have 2a plus b equal to 1. which means A equal to minus 1 and B equal to 3. So the GS by the partial fraction, we have minus 1 per S plus 1 and 3 per S plus 2. The impulse response is the inverse Laplace of GS. It depends on the form of this one. So 1 per S plus 1, we're gonna have E power minus T. And the second term is E power minus 2T. The pole of this system is minus 1 and minus 2, real pole. So we are not going to see vibration from these real poles. We only see the exponential decay due to the poles, minus 1 and minus 2. And we are not going to see the vibration by the real pole. So the poles indicate the response characteristic. Means indicate the form of the response, whether it's gonna vibrate or it's gonna decay. If it's gonna vibrate, the omega D or the damped natural frequency is depend on the value of the pole. If it's not vibrate, the time constant is depend on the first and the second value of the pole. If we change the pole value, for example, if the pole is minus 10, E power minus T, what is the E power minus T? It's gonna be something like this, right? But maybe if the value of the pole is changed, maybe the decay may be faster, maybe faster. So the pole indicate the response characteristic, whether it's gonna vibrate or it's just a decay, and how fast is the decay, or how is the frequency of the vibration, is indicated by the pole. The zero just affect the magnitude of the response. The zero just affect the magnitude of the response, but the pole affect the response characteristic. And here is also a review. If you already have taken the vibration class, you should familiar with this response characteristic matching with the pole location. Before we talk about this conclusion, we may begin from the basic system. And the transfer function of this system output divided by the input. When we need to transform the MCK to the standard form of second order system, standard form of second order system, I'm gonna have 1 per k and multiply it by k. And I'm gonna divide the numerator and denominator by m. And now we can have the standard form of second order system. The standard form means it's going to be written in the term of the natural frequency and the damping ratio. And I hope you still remember how can we relate the natural frequency and the damping ratio to the system parameter MCK. But I begin from this because the root of the characteristic equation gonna be the pole of this system. So the pole gonna be the root of this polynomial equal to zero or the characteristic equation. From the quadratic root of this, we have minus, no, S1 and S2. The quadratic root has two root, right? And S1 and S2 gonna be minus 2 psi omega n and plus minus the square root of 4 psi square omega n square minus 4 omega n square and divide by 2. The first and the second relate to the positive and then negative sign here. But the first and the second pole are gonna be minus psi omega n plus and minus j omega n square root 1 minus psi square. And this is the damped natural frequency, the damped natural frequency. If we plot the root on the S plane, we're gonna have two poles. And the real part gonna be minus psi omega n. And the imaginary part as the complex conjugate gonna be j omega d and minus j omega d. And if we have this angle, the triangle here have the angle phi. And the length here gonna be and on the opposite side, the length here gonna be omega n square root 1 minus psi square. And on this side it's gonna be omega n multiplied by 1. So this angle is related to the damping ratio. This angle is related to the damping ratio. Cosine of this angle. Cosine of this angle is equal to the damping ratio divided by 1. Cosine of this angle is equal to damping ratio divided by 1. So it means that if the damping ratio is increased, the damping ratio increases, the angle should be small or big if the damping ratio increases. If the damping ratio increase, if the damping ratio is zero, if the damping ratio increase, the system is not going to vibrate if the angle is small. The system will extremely vibrate if the angle is big. So if the damping ratio increase, the angle will small. If we consider the location of the pole on the S plane, the location of the pole on the S plane, we already mentioned that if the pole only have the real value, if the pole only have the real value, we are not going to see the vibration. We are not going to see the vibration. And if the pole is on the left-hand side, the system gonna be stable. Stable means the value gonna decrease against the time. If the pole is on the right-hand side, the magnitude gonna increase with the time. If the pole is on the left-hand side, and far from the imaginary axis. If the real part has the big number, if the real part has the big number, the system gonna be fast. Compare this and this. If the value of the real value, the magnitude is big, the system gonna be fast. And if the system only have the real part, it's not gonna vibrate. If the pole is on the left-hand side, it's stable. Stable means the magnitude decrease. Unstable means the magnitude increase with time and unbound. If we have the imaginary part of the root, if we have imaginary part of the root, the system gonna vibrate. The system gonna vibrate. If it's pure imaginary number, no real part, only have the imaginary part, magnitude not increase and not decrease, the vibration also. Magnitude not increase and not decrease. The chain of the magnitude of the imaginary part affect the frequency of the vibration. Omega D will be if the imaginary part is far from the origin. Have big imaginary part, omega D gonna be big, high frequency of vibration compared to this one, And the real part gonna affect the decay of magnitude, If the real part is on the left-hand side, system stable, magnitude of vibration decay with time. But if the magnitude of the vibration increase with time, the psi omega n minus, the magnitude, if minus psi omega n is more than zero, the pole gonna be on the right hand side, and magnitude of vibration will increase with time, and the system is unstable. So to sum up, the real value, tell us whether the system gonna stable or unstable. If the real part is negative, system stable, magnitude decrease with time. If the real part more than zero, the system unstable, the magnitude increase with time. And the imaginary part indicate whether the system gonna vibrate or not. If the imaginary part is zero, the root gonna be on the real axis and no vibration. If the omega D or the imaginary part is non-zero, if it big, vibration will have high frequency compared to when the omega D is small. So we need to review about the pole location on S-plane, because the root locus gonna talk about the position of the root of the characteristic equation. The root locus gonna talk about the location of the pole of the system when we change the gain K of the controller. Cross loop and open loop transfer function. This slide is also just a review, Cross loop. The cross loop transfer function is the output divided by the input. Cross loop transfer function gonna be the feed forward gain. Divide by one plus the loop gain. If we talk about the characteristic equation, keep in mind, we are talking about the closed loop transfer function, not open loop. And the characteristic equation means the denominator equal to zero equal to 0. If we define the open loop transfer function, is the loop gain. The characteristic equation here, if we write in the form of the open loop transfer function, it seems like we have 1 plus it depends on the gain. And the open loop transfer function maybe the good definition for open loop transfer function, when we not consider the controller, open loop transfer function should be the transfer function of the system multiplied by the transfer function of the sensor or the feedback. And we not consider the controller, Open loop transfer function need to be the system multiplied by the feedback. And the sensor, the controller still be can vary the gain. So if we define the open loop transfer function, is the transfer function of the system multiplied by the feedback or the sensor as the open loop transfer function. The closed loop characteristic equation can be written as 1 plus K G OS equal to 0. And the TOS is the system transfer function and the feedback or the sensor. From this characteristic equation in the form of the open loop transfer function, the product of the plant transfer function and the sensor, the magnitude of the plant multiplied by the sensor gonna be minus 1 per K of the controller. This gonna be magnitude criteria. When we change the gain, the root of the characteristic equation need to be satisfy the magnitude criteria. But In this light, to avoid confusion, maybe we just focus on the meaning of the closed loop transfer function, the characteristic equation, and the definition of the open loop transfer function first. And the open loop transfer function itself consists of the part of the system and the sensor, the system and the sensor. The system actually, the gain that multiply to the system, many times we combine it together to be just a transfer function of the plan. But this block diagram may try to separate the gain, but the open loop transfer function will be in the form of the numerator divided by the denominator. And the numerator is the product of S minus zero. And for example, if we have S plus one, S plus two, S plus three, S plus four. The numerator is the product of S plus zero and the pi. Maybe we may familiar with the summation, right? The pi sum the product. No, the pi have the product of the first zero, second zero, until m zero, if we have m zero. And the denominator also the product of the pole. We have M zero, we have N pole. The number of pole and zero don't need to be equal. But the open loop transfer function is numerator divided by denominator. The concept of the Ludlow class, we may begin from a simple transfer function. We may begin from a simple transfer function. KA. In this case, if the transfer function is one per S plus one, maybe just consider KA equal to one and the feedback equal to one for this analysis, and K is the proportional gain that can be changed by the controller. We're gonna see how the root of the characteristic equation or the pole of the system gonna change when we change the value of the proportional gain to this system. The closed loop transfer function output divided by input gonna be K GS divided by one plus K GS, the closed loop transfer function. And when GS is this one, K 1 per s s plus 1 divide by 1 plus k 1 per s s plus 1We have k divided by 1 plus, sorry. We have k divided by, we need to multiply this to 1, right? S squared plus s plus k. So the characteristic equation, is s squared plus s plus k equal to 0. You can consider, the characteristic equation from this one equal to 0, or the original, this one equal to 0. These two equations for the characteristic equation are equivalent. From this system, what should be the pole of this system? The pole of this system is obtained from the characteristic equation. Let's find the quadratic root of this characteristic equation. S1 and S2 gonna be minus 1 plus minus square root 1 square minus 4 1 k divided by 2. Minus 1 per 2 plus and minus square root 1 minus 4 k divided by 2. It depends on the k of this system. It depends on the k of the controller. But from the original system, the pole location gonna be 0 and minus 1, right? From the original system, the pole gonna be at 0 and minus 1. The root locus, when we increase the value of the k, the location of the pole gonna change, to somewhere. When we increase the value of the k, when k is 0, the location of the pole will be at the original position of the pole from the transfer function. When k is equal to 0, the pole location gonna be minus 1 per 2 plus when k is equal to 0 when k is equal to 0, the position of the root gonna be at minus 1 and at 0 correspond to the original root of the characteristic equation when k equal to 0. When we increase the value of the k, the first and the second pole gonna shift its position to somewhere, And the system property gonna change depending on the value of the k of the controller. Today, in the chapter of the root locus, the analysis of the root locus in today's class will give you an idea that if we have only one pole and we change the value of k, how can the position of the root gonna be changed, the position? If we have two pole like this system, when we change the k, where the root gonna be located? When we have more than two pole, in the system, where the position of the root gonna be changed depending on the value of the gain k, So we can know that by sketch a root locus of the system. And to sketch the root locus of the system, the background idea is come from the magnitude criteria and the phase angle criteria. For the magnitude criteria, we begin from this characteristic equation. The characteristic equation is 1 plus k and the open loop transfer function equal to 0. So when we change the gain k, the value of the s gonna be changed, but this should still be true. The magnitude criteria, is the magnitude of the gain multiplied by the open loop transfer function need to equal to 1, the magnitude criteria. Again, this open loop need to be G multiplied by H, K is this one. The phase angle or the angular criteria the gain is a constant and the gain don't have the phase angle, but the transfer function, consists of the real and imaginary root, it's gonna have the phase. The angular criteria, minus one, when we consider minus one, the angle that measure from the real, to minus one is 180 degrees. It depends on the number of the pole, but the general definition for the angle in angular criteria, it should be 180 degree, maybe plus or minus L multiplied by one revolution. And L can be 1, 2, 3, depending on the number of the poles. But to satisfy the magnitude and angular criteria, if the system have n pole, if the system has n pole, or the pole, or the S value should be satisfied the magnitude criteria, should be satisfied the magnitude criteria, and satisfy the angular criteria. The first pole in the angular criteria may satisfy when L equal to 1. The second pole may satisfy when L equal to 2, equal to 3. It means maybe the angle or the location actually is the same, 180, but because 180 plus one revolution, plus two revolution, plus three, or minus one, minus two, minus three revolution, the sketch here, the graphical one are the same, but the algebraic one may be different. But here is the magnitude and angular criteria. In this slide, maybe it's still not so clear for you, but don't worry. But based on this magnitude and angular criteria, we provide the method to sketch the root locus, and we can apply this criteria to identify the angular criteria can be used to identify if a pole is on the root locus or not. If we have this transfer function by the angular criteria, we can identify whether one value on S plane, one value on S plane is on the root locus or not. From the transfer function, we begin from the characteristic equation. Characteristic equation means 1 plus k open loop transfer function equal to 0. The root of the characteristic equation are the pole. The root of the characteristic equation are the pole. So 1 plus k s plus 1 divided by s plus 2 we may solve this and find the root to be the pole, or we may just consider the open loop transfer function. This is the transfer function of the system, and the feedback, the sensor transfer function is equal to 1. This one is the open loop transfer function. You may solve the characteristic equation to get the value of the pole, or you may just directly consider the open loop transfer function. to identify the pole and the zero. Pole, key one, or the first pole. When the pole means the characteristic equation equal to zero, if S equal to zero, if S equal to zero, this characteristic equation gonna be zero. So the first possible pole is P1 equal to zero. How about this term? How about this term? S plus two square plus four equal to zero. S plus two equal to plus minus square root minus four, right? So S equal to minus, oh, sorry, minus two, and plus 2j and minus 2 minus 2j. So from this we have two possible pole. One possible one is minus 2 plus 2j. Another one is minus 2 minus 2j. How about this one? How about this one? The pole that relate to S plus 5 equal to zero is minus 5. This system has four pole, has four pole. How about zero? We have only one zero. We have only one zero. If we plot the pole and zero, if we plot the pole and zero on an S-plane, on an S-plane, the first pole, the pole will be plot as the cross mark. The zero gonna be plot by zero. The first pole, the second one will be right, minus two plus 2j and minus two j. The last pole will be on minus 5. So we have four pole and we have one zero. We have one zero. The zero gonna be here. The zero gonna be here at minus 1 on the real axis. My question to this problem is, if we have one value, if we have one value equal to minus 1 plus 2j, if we have one value equal to minus 1 plus 2j, the position of that value gonna be here. The position of that value gonna be here. Minus 1 plus 2j. Do you think this one is on the root locus or not? The meaning is, if we change the gain k, if we change the gain k of the controller, is it possible to move one pole, this, or some pole, to cross this position on the S-plane, is it possible to move the system property to that location or not? If it's possible to change the K and make the system to be at that position, S0, S6, or that value on the S-plane should be on the root locus, should be on the root locus. But how can we check if the S6 will be on the root locus or not? We're gonna apply the angular criteria. We're gonna apply the angular criteria. To use the angular criteria, this slide from now, the technique from now is important. The phase angle of this position need to be considered from all pole and zero in this system. The angle generated by pole gonna be positive. The angle generated by The angle generated by zero, gonna be positive. The angle generated by zero gonna be positive. The angle generated by pole gonna be negative. In this system, we have one zero. This one is the unknown angle that generated by the zero, but we still have four pole. The angle generated by pole, four pole, gonna be negative. We have one zero and we have four pole. The angle generated by zero will consider positive. The angle generated by pole will be considered as negative. What is the angle generated by zero? The zero is here at minus one. When we draw a line from the position of the zero to the S6, the angle means this one. The angle will measure from the positive direction of the real to that position of S6, which means this angle. The position of the zero is minus one. And the position of S6 is minus one plus 2j. So the direction measured from the real axis to the position of S6 is 90 degrees. How about the angle we measure from the first pole to the S6? We draw the line, connect the first pole at zero to the S6. And the angle is measured from the positive real axis. Of course, the angle can be obtained from the arctan. Of the imaginary displacement two divided by the real displacement . How about the second pole? The second pole is this one. When we draw a line from the second pole to S6, the line is a horizontal line, right? A horizontal line. Because we have the same 2J, a horizontal line is parallel to the positive real axis. So the angle between the line and the positive real axis is zero for the second pole. For the second pole. For the third pole, for the third pole, the third pole is this one. We draw a line between the third pole and the S6, and the angle should be this one. Measure from the horizontal axis to the line that connect between the third pole and S6. Again, we need to use the arctan. We need to use the arctan. The imaginary part, the difference in the imaginary part between the S6 and the pole, the vertical value gonna be the difference between 2 and -2. The vertical gonna be 4. The horizontal value, the difference between -2 and -1. The horizontal value gonna be +1. And the last pole, -5. We draw a line that connect the -5 to the S6. The angle is this one. The angle measure from the positive real axis to the line that connect between the pole and the S6. Again, we need to employ the arctan. The vertical value is 2. The horizontal value between -5 and -1 gonna be 4. So finally, the numerical value of all the angle gonna be 90 degrees minus 10 of -2. The numerical value gonna be 116 degree and 0, and the arctan of 4 and the arctan of 1/2. So the numerical value, the sum of this angle is -129.2. 129.2 is not satisfy the angular criteria. It's not equal to 180 plus and minus 360 degree. So this one is not satisfy the angular criteria, which means the F6 is not on the locus of the root. Although we change the gain K to any value, it's impossible to make the pole of the system to be on the minus one plus two J. It's impossible. We cannot decide the gain K to satisfy the position of S6. It's not satisfy the angular criteria. So this is an example how can we apply the angular criteria to consider whether we can design a control system by changing the gain K, and we can get the system property for one location of the root on the S plane. From the example here, what we can do now is, now we know how to plot the position of the pole and the zero on the S plane. We know how to plot the pole and zero on S plane from an open loop transfer function. You see here, we have the open loop transfer function. We list the pole and we list the zeros, and we plot the cross mark and plot the O or the zero on the S plane. We know how to do it. And the fact that we need to know is at the pole, the gain K equal to zero. At the pole, the gain K equal to zero. Maybe from here, we know that when the gain K of controller equal to zero, the position of the root will exactly on the position of the pole. If gain K equal to zero, the position of the root, the location of the root is located on the position of the pole, exactly on the pole, zero and minus one, when K equal to zero. Another fact is when K is very, very big, the location of the root, will be at the zero. When K is zero, root are at pole. When K is zero, the root are at pole. When K getting bigger, the root will change the location from the pole to the location of zero. If we have the number of the pole equal to the number of zero, it's not gonna be a problem, because when we change the gain K, the value of the root will shift from the value of the pole to the position of the zero. But what's gonna happen if we have 1, 2, 3, and 4, if we have four pole, but we have only one zero. Similar to this problem, we have four pole, but we have only one zero. That's gonna be one pole that the value approach to the zero. For another pole, the value will go to infinite. Go to infinite in somewhere. This one can directly go to minus infinite. For this pole, the value may be shift to some infinite with the asymptote. Infinite with the asymptote. Today, we will know how to draw asymptote line that give an idea. If we increase the value of k to very, very big k, how can the root of the system follow the asymptote? But before we are talking about the asymptote, this mark is important. If we have pole and zero on the real axis, the root gonna locate on the left order. It means we combine the pole and zero together on the real axis. And the root gonna be on the left-hand side of the first, the third, and the fifth, the odd order. You cannot see the root on the left-hand side of the second pole or the first zero, second zero and the fourth pole. Impossible. The root only can be on the left of the odd number of pole or zero. For a system with only one pole, the root will go from the pole to infinite. Which means when we increase the gain k, the system just perform faster, because when we go to the left hand side of the S plane, the system just go faster when we increase the gain k. That is makes sense when we have one pole. When we have one pole, the root will locate on the left-hand side of the pole. If we have more than one pole, for example, if we have two pole, the first pole and the second pole, we cannot see the locus of the root on the left-hand side of the even pole, but the root will be here on the left-hand side of the odd pole. And after the gain chain, the root will move to the right-hand side of the second pole and move to the left-hand side of the first pole. It's gonna hit somewhere and then break away and follow the asymptote. In the next class, we will talk about the breakaway point. Also, if they have the break-in, we will talk about the break-in in next class. But today, the asymptote, we will talk about the asymptote. The asymptote will guide when we increase the value of the k, where the root will be located on the locus. And the asymptote are described by two value. The first value of the asymptote. Wait a second. Asymptote will be described by the angle measure from the positive real axis. And asymptote will describe by the intersection point that it crossed the real axis. Asymptote will be described by the angle it make with the real axis. And described by the intersection point to the real axis. So by this definition, maybe it's not easy, still not so clear for you. How can we draw asymptote? But if we have this example, if we have this example, it should be easy for you. We begin from pole. This system have the third order. The first pole is s equal to 0. The second and the third pole. Do you have any idea the second and the third pole? We will begin from s plus 4 square plus 16 equal to 0. So s plus 4 equal to minus 16 square root and plus and minus. So s equal to minus 4 plus minus 4j. So the second pole, minus 4 plus 4j and minus 4 minus 4j. Do we have 0? Do we have 0 in this system? We don't have s plus a. We don't have s plus a in the denominator. We don't have 0. We don't have 0. When we locate the position of pole on the s plane, we have pole at 0. We have pole at minus 4 plus 4j and minus 4j. And what we need to do is to draw asymptote. We know that the pole, the locus of the root should begin from the pole location when k equal to 0. When k equal to 0, the root will be at the pole. And when k approach infinite, the locus of the root should be at the 0. But in this system, we don't have 0. We don't have 0. Which means when k approach infinite, the location of the root gonna be at infinite. How can we guide the location of the root when k approach infinite? We need to guide it by asymptote. We need to guide it by asymptote. So the number of pole is 3. The number of 0 is 0. It means we need to find 3 asymptotes. We need to find 3 asymptotes. Asymptote is obtained by the angular criteria. and they make the intersection point angular criteria and intersection point the angle. We have three asymptotes. We have three asymptotes. The angle of three asymptotes is obtained by 180 plus and minus L multiplied by 160 degree divided by the number of pole subtract by number of zero. Which means we are going to have 180 degree plus minus L multiplied by 360. Number of pole, number of zero. The possible angle, 180 divided by 3, 60 degree. 180 plus 360 divided by 3. 180 plus 360 will be 540. 540 divided by 3. The third asymptote, you may obtain from this. The third asymptote by this gonna be 900 divided by 3, right? 300 degree. Or it's equivalent to 180 divided by 180 minus 360 and divide by 3, we're gonna have minus 60 degree. Positive 300 and minus 60 are equivalent. So now the possible angle here is this angle. How about the intersection? Intersection is summation of pole minus summation of zero divided by number of pole subtract by number of zero. Summation zero divided by n minus m. Summation value of pole, minus 8. We don't have zero. Summation value of zero is zero. N minus m. So the intersection point that the asymptote gonna cross the real axis gonna be at minus 8 per 3. And the angle of the asymptote, the first asymptote will have 60 degree. The second asymptote will have 180 degree. The third asymptote gonna be minus 60 or 300 degree. So in this system, we have three asymptotes with one intersection point and three different angles of the asymptote. Of course, in this system, we have three poles. And we know that the pole on the real axis gonna have the root locus on the left-hand side of that pole on the real axis. And another two, the other two pole gonna create the root locus and the root locus should go to the zero, but we don't have the zero for them. So the locus will follow asymptote, follow the asymptote when we increase the value of the k gain. Another question is, how can I know that when the increase of the gain k, the locus will go in this way and follow asymptote, or will it just go like this and follow asymptote? The angle that the locus kick itself from the pole, the angle when the locus with the angle that the root locus make with the positive real axis, this angle we call angle of departure. How can we know that we're gonna have the positive angle of departure in the counterclockwise direction, or we're gonna have the negative one departure like here with the negative angle? For angle of departure, it needs to satisfy the angular criteria. We begin from assume one position. We assume one position of the locus near the pole. These two positions is very, very close, very close. And we assume S zero cross. We assume S zero locate very close to a pole that we want to find the angle of departure. If we want to find the angle of departure of this pole, we're gonna define S zero very close to the pole, and the angle that we need to obtain is the angle of departure here. For the complex conjugate pole, luckily, the angle of departure will be symmetric about the real axis. Will be symmetric. So if we have P2 and P3 as complex conjugate, we only need to obtain the angle of departure for P2. For P3, it will be symmetric across the real axis. The pole location, this transfer function are the same. The pole location will be at 0 minus 4 plus 4j and minus 4 minus 4j. The angular criteria, we need to consider we don't have zero right here. We have only pole. We need to find the angle that the line that connect between the first pole and S zero. And this angle is the first angle. The second pole, we have the line that connect between the second pole and S0. Of course, S0 is very close to the pole 2, but the angle that we are going to find here is the angle of departure. The angle that the third pole make with S0 is this angle. When S0 is very close to the pole 2, maybe this angle can be assumed to be 90 degrees. We can assume that S0 maybe locate on the position of pole 2. Maybe the line that connect between pole 2 and pole 3 is the vertical line. It's make 90 degrees with the real axis. The sum of the angle will be the first pole, the second pole angle, and the third pole angle. We have the negative side here because the angle is measured from the pole. If we measure from the zero, please keep in mind that we are not going to have the negative sign for zero. We only have the negative sign for pole. But in this problem, we don't have zero. We have three poles. The first angle here, the magnitude can be obtained from the arctan. Arctan of the vertical 4 divided by the horizontal minus 4. For the pole 2, we need to find the angle of departure by assume S0, but of course we don't know where is the exact position of S0, but it's very close to the position of pole 2. The angle of departure is still unknown. For the third pole, the numerical value may be, we can be assumed to be 90 degrees. The line that connects between the third pole and S0 is perpendicular to the horizontal axis. But if we want to write it in the term of the arctan, we may begin from the vertical value x and the horizontal value S0 is very close to P2, and P2 and P3 lie on the same vertical line. So the horizontal displacement gonna be zero. So arctan of minus one the angle 2 still unknown. Arctan of infinite, positive infinite, angle is 90 degrees. This angle should satisfy the angular criteria. Satisfy the angular criteria. Wait a second. When we need to divide by n minus n, n minus m is when we need to obtain the intersection point or the angle of asymptote. But the angular criteria itself, the angular criteria itself, we don't need to divide by n minus m. So the angle here to satisfy the angular criteria, to satisfy the angular criteria. So the angle of departure, the angle of departure may be minus 90 degree and maybe from this side we plus by 180. And what we have minus 45 degree. So in this case, the angle of departure is minus 45 degree. It means it should be like here. Minus means it should be measured from the positive real axis to the clockwise when we see the minus. If it's positive, it's gonna be follow the counterclockwise. But if it's negative, it means the angle of departure here should be in this direction. Angle of arrival and angle of departure, we use the same technique. The technique is we assume S0 close to the pole location for angle of departure. For angle of arrival, we assume S0 near zero because we know that the root locus line will approach the zero position when we increase the gain K, when we increase the gain K. So this is gonna be the last example for today. And in this example, we will review angle of departure and angle of arrival together. We may begin from finding the pole and zero of this system first. Pole and zero of this system first. Maybe you can obtain pole zero directly from the quadratic root, from the quadratic root. Pole should be minus 2 plus minus square root 4 minus 8 divided by 2. It means, is that correct? 4 minus 2 plus minus square root 2 square plus 4 multiplied by 2 divided by 2. P1 equal to P2 equal to P1 is minus 1 plus J. P2 is minus 1 minus J. How about 0? Zero is minus 6 plus minus square root 4 multiplied by 18 is that correct? Yeah, it should be. So zero So in this system, we have two pole and two zero. We have two pole and two zero. Let's locate the pole and zero on the S plane. The pole will be at minus one plus one J and minus one J. And the zero gonna be and we have two pole, we have two zero. We have two pole, we have two zero. So in this problem, we don't need to find asymptote. We don't need to find asymptote. But we need to find the angle of departure and angle of arrival. To find angle of departure, we assume S zero cross to the pole. And we have the unknown angle here. We have the unknown angle here. S zero, we need to consider the angle measured from the first zero. Angle measured from the first zero. The angle measured from the second zero. The angle measured from the first pole and the angle measured from the second pole. And when we consider the angle measure from the zero, it's gonna be positive. When we consider the angle measure from pole, it's gonna be negative. The angle considered from the first zero, the angle measured from the first zero, the vertical value gonna be two, right? Minus two. And the horizontal value, gonna be two, is measured from minus three to minus one. We locate S zero. In this case, for the angle of departure, we locate S zero near pole because the root locus depart from pole, The angle from the 0, 2. The angle from the 0, 2, the vertical value, is 4. And the horizontal value is 2. We still don't know the angle of departure from the first pole. For the second pole, we know that S zero located very close to the first pole. So for the second pole, maybe from here you can simply be put 90 degree. But the numerical value is arctan of 2 divided by 0. And we have from the first 0 is minus 45 degree. From the second zero, is positive 63.4 degree. From the first pole, angle of departure still unknown. And finally, for the second pole, we know that it's 90 degrees. 90 degrees here. And this should satisfy the angular criteria. So what should be the angle of departure? Angle of departure may be minus 45 plus 63 minus 90 degree. And should be plus or minus? Should be plus 180. What gonna be? And finally, the angle of departure gonna be 108.4 degree. Which mean angle of departure is more than 90 degree, right? It's more than 90 degree. So it should be about here, more than 90 degree. And point to the zero. To obtain the angle of arrival, we use the same technique. I'm gonna recap the pole location on the S plane to here again. We have imaginary and the real, and the pole location minus one, and the zero position 3 and -3. And the angle of arrival, we assume S0 near S0. A zero here. Let's assume S0 somewhere near 0, 1. And the angle of arrival that we are going to find is the unknown. We know that from pole 1 connect to S0, we're gonna have an angle, this one, from pole 2, we're gonna have an angle. From 0, 1 is unknown angle. From 0, 2, Because S0 is very close to C1, the angle that we measure for the 0, 2, maybe 90 degree. So the angular criteria, the sum of the angle, is the angle from 0, 1, angle from 0, 2, minus angle from pole 1, minus angle from pole 2. Angle from 0, 1, still unknown, and we need to find it. Angle from 0, 2 is just 90 degree. Angle from pole 1, angle from pole 1 is arctan of 2 divided by minus 2. Angle from pole 2, angle from pole 2 we have 4 divided by minus 2. Unknown angle plus 90 degree minus 135 minus 116 need to be satisfy the angular criteria. So the angle of arrival, of the 0, 1 may be, let me think. Minus 100 plus, no. Minus 90 plus it should be slightly less than 0. So the angle of arrival, in this case, the angle of arrival is less than 0. It means it should be clockwise, measure from the horizontal line. So from, by considering, again, we have pole, and we have 0 there. The angle of departure is 108 degree. This line, 108 degree. And the angle of arrival is minus 80.4, 108 degrees. So maybe the locus, the root locus maybe is a curve between this, And as I mentioned, it's gonna symmetric against the real axis. You don't need to obtain this, you don't need to obtain this. It's gonna symmetric. Okay, that's all for today lecture. And next week, we are not going to have a class on next week. I think it's a public holiday. So next week we are not going to have class. And after that, we're gonna continue on how can we find the intersection to the imaginary axis. of the root locus. This one is important because we're gonna know when the system gonna be unstable. Maybe we should refer to the route stability criteria again. Maybe I cannot remember, but when we talk about whether the system gonna be stable or unstable, maybe we should use the stability criteria. We're gonna apply stability criteria to the root locus to identify when the root locus gonna intersect to the imaginary axis. And as I mentioned, maybe when we have the pole, the root gonna be on the left hand side of the odd order pole. When it hit each other, it need to follow the asymptote again, but it should break away. It's gonna increase when we increase again. And when it hit, it need to break away from the real axis. We are talking about the breakaway point. And when it come back to approach, it's gonna be a break in. And the technique to sketch root locus, the guideline, we can do it by hand. You need to know how to do in the exam, we will have in the exam. But we also have the MATLAB tool to obtain the same results. And how can we apply this to obtain the gain, to decide again? So that we have the desired damping ratio and the frequency that we want from the response. โอเคครับวันนี้เท่านี้ก่อนมีคำถามไหม